We are selling newspapers. Do you know what they'll be discussing about? The problems of this country. Have you noticed? When you see them gather, and Henry Ford said this, do not identify a fault. Identify what? The solution. Why? Because if truly Nigeria has problems, as it were, then get to our airport and ask yourself, why are so many expatriates coming here? As Nigerians are leaving, you have expatriates, Lebanese, Chinese, Indians. In their cap, they are all coming. That means they are seeing something we are not seeing, isn't it? Next slide. The situation is still fighting one cause for over 20 years. How many leaders do we have today within our environment that will be willing to stay, even in the midst of chaos in Nigeria, at the high level of insecurity, will be willing to stay in our businesses to see it through, even when nothing seems to be working? Even when there seems to be no good roads, when there seems to be no light, when there seems to be Yahoo all over the place, but there are people who beg to differ, to think differently, that in my own generation we are going to see that things will turn around and that things will change. Do you know why Obama won the election? Do you know what was his slogan? Change. Why do you think people voted for Buhari? Do you know what it was? Now, do you know one of the greatest desires of humans is change? Nobody desires to remain in the same condition for his own. So, the ultimate test of leadership is how you perform in crisis. Without a Goliath, there would never have been a David. So, problems are good. You cannot run a river. You need problems to be able to be promoted to leadership. Problems bring out the leadership in them. Indirectly, problems are good. So, if we keep complaining about the problems in our society, in our economy, and in our organizations, trust me, we will not rise. One man's problem is another man's opportunity for advancement. Next slide. So, this man declared and showed leadership. Why? He had the audacity. And he wrote a book on it. How many of us have read the book of this young man? Audacity. Audacity means offensive strategy to dare to go forward, even when nothing. Do you have the audacity to still remain, even when all your counterparts are traveling to Canada, saying that I will see that a change happened in my lifetime? Meaning that you establish a business that changes the course of things because you have the audacity to look at all of the insecurity and challenges in the face in our society and say, listen, you will still make a difference in this environment. Take someone who's a leader to have audacity. This man had audacity to be able to stand it and see it through, irrespective of the fact that there had not been any record of a black man ever ruling America. He was the first ever. So he established what is called direction and gave all of the black personalities in America and a sense of belonging. Who would have thought that a black man would ever rule America? This man made that possible. That is the issue. Next. Attacking you and things are challenging you when things are not appearing as they ought to be. It takes courage to constrain yourself emotionally. Do you know, it is easier for you to display strength than for you to constrain yourself emotionally. The easiest thing to do is to display strength by beating someone else, by slapping another woman, by slapping your subordinate in the office. But it takes courage when a subordinate in your office does something wrong and you constrain yourself emotionally and you are able to talk calmly to that person to correct that person, not to react in an emotional outburst. We call that
that's the last of revolutionary thing. Why? Inability to be courageously patient. This is what this man is doing for over 20 years.
Leadership is more of you than what you do.
If I ask some people, what do you do? They think leadership is not what you do. Leadership is about who you are. Do you know, you do not attract the people you want. You attract the who you are. That is how it works. Even if you want people who are disciplined, who are courageous, people who are hardworking, the question is, are you hardworking? Are you courageous? Are you patient? You don't attract your organization the people you want to work on. You attract who you are. That's, those are the people. Yeah, that's what you attract to your organization. So if you are not that thing, you will not attract the people that are like you. Secondly, leaders are made, not born. How many of us believe? Some people have the notion and say that leaders are born. That leaders are born. Is that true? Are leaders born? That means someone like Nelson Mandela will never have been a leader. But leaders are made. How? By self-discipline. It means you can make a leader out of anybody. From the streets. You can make a leader from somebody who's a non-entity, who looks hopeless, who's not followed. So if you are a leader in your organization, the question is that you should have someone succeeding you. That means you should have what is called someone who is going to take over from you. Once the business dies, the business, once it dies, what happens to the business? Once the owner dies, right? The business strategy. Example, I will love. Imagine, no matter how people say it, even in our churches today, some churches are mediocre and they believe that by reason of laying hands on people, they will attain leadership. So you see politicians going to churches to meet pastors to say, pray for me so that I can function as a leader. It is like saying that a pilot, somebody who desires to function as a pilot, comes to you as a pastor and says, pray for me to fly this airplane. And then he says, all your members should enter the plane and fly them for you. Even you, even the pastor will not enter. That is how stupid it sounds. Why? Because it is a skill that is important. It doesn't come by laying on of hands. It doesn't come by unction or by anointing. It is a skill that is learned. Why do you think God took time for David in the Bible to have learned? He said he led and led Israel by skill. Skillfully he led Israel. So he acquired skill. So it wasn't just the fact that he was anointed. It mattered. Next slide. The most valuable asset is your ability to think. And leaders do one very major thing. Think about the future. If I were to ask you, what do you think is the plan for your organization in the next 50 years, in the next 100 years? Do you know that Toyota has a 200-year plan for its organization? How many of our organizations, as we are sitting, have a 200-year plan for our organization? That is how far they've gone. Listen, Dubai did not just emerge out of coincidence or luck. There are men who pay the price for generations of demands. But a leader coaches. What does a boss do? Relies on authority. But what does a leader do? Model. He's a role model today. What does a boss do? Issue ultimatums. Give deadlines. But what does a leader do? Generates enthusiasm. What does a boss do? Use people. What does a leader do? Develop people. When was the last time
your organization sent you on a trip to equip you. If you are spending your own money to train yourself, that means the organization has failed you. That's what it means. Because that means they don't place premium and value on staff development. What does the boss do? Takes credit. While the leader gives credit. What does the boss do? Plays the blame game. Next slide. So there's a difference between a manager and a leader. What's the difference? Next slide. Not because it's necessarily like that. Because we are appointed as head of that particular unit, or that particular department. So people have no choice but to follow. You find that, have you seen leaders who are heading a position, and when they leave that position, people start telling them, go catch you. Because they never like saying the person. Why? They have no choice. They have to follow. Next, be as next, permissional leadership. This level is much better, which is people follow you because they like you. You are not up there. Like what used to happen in some of our churches. I do remember those days, we have churches that we have all our pastors and deacons will be seated on the altar. And then the congregation will be down. So, you understand? And they'll be looking at them. There's no relational leadership. That's why productive. That's why they call it. We call it productional leadership. That is the next level most of our organizations should be looking at. Next. So what is wrong with this picture, really? I was looking at this picture. What's wrong with this picture?
It's for maintenance.
Can you see? What is wrong with this picture?
Our resources.
So with this number of ladders that this young man has, look at this number of ladders. You understand? With this number of resources Nigeria has, with this number of people that Nigeria has, why would MTN move his head office from South Africa to Nigeria? He has seen something we have not seen. Have you noticed? Why would MultiChoice move his head office here? And you have DSTV, they even brought it down to voting, not stopping there with more, many people up to now. They have what is called Schumann. What do you think they are seeing that we are not seeing? Because we have resources that the problem is not the absence of the resources, but our inability to utilize them. We don't know how to use them. My friend Steve Harris always says this. He said that it's what you don't have. That's not the problem. That, oh, I don't have this. That's not your problem. The problem is what you have, but don't know how to use it. That's the problem. It means you have certain things, but the problem is that you're not taught or you don't know how to utilize them yet.
Ladies and gentlemen.